Okay, my thoughts on Michael Bloomberg and all the other Democrats running for president, the latest on the coronavirus, and I also respond to your questions. Hey guys, it's February 13th, 2020, originally also known as DemCat. Welcome to the DemCat channel. All right, first, 15 cases in the United States. There's been 15 confirmed cases of the coronavirus in the United States. So far, the CDC is warning that there could be a lot more, it could be more coming. It looks like the US military is sort of preparing for a pandemic. They're at least preparing for it, which they should be doing. Japan reported their first death in this coronavirus pandemic. Also, there's a Norwegian cruise ship. Although there's reports, they're claiming that no, they're not actually quarantining a passenger. It's not related to the coronavirus, but we'll see there. We don't really know what's really happening there. It's just it's popping up in a lot of different places in China. They're actually going about reporting the cases differently. Now, for the longest, they basically just relied on labs. Where they suspected somebody had the coronavirus, they sent the tests to the labs and waited for the results. And then when it came back positive, then okay, we have a positive case, we have a confirmed case. Well, now what they're doing now is just going by the clinical. For example, if a doctor comes across somebody who has a lot of the symptoms and they meet all the symptoms and they're checking off all the boxes and stuff, just from a clinical standpoint, they just say, hey, we're going to treat this person as if this person actually has the virus. So they're counting these people as being infected. I think that's part of the reason why the official case number has been so low. It recently increased by about 14,000, 15,000 just from yesterday. And I think it's another 4,000 or 5,000 just recently. So I think they have over 65,000 cases of coronavirus. And I think they have tens of thousands of people actually hospitalized because of this. And this is why they need to build so many hospital beds over there in China. I think they have a total of 1,400 deaths. Now, obviously we can't say for sure whether all that is accurate or not, but part of the problem has been that they may have been running out of tests, and that's why the number of reported cases have been stagnant. They've probably been waiting on those tests, and now they're able to move a little bit faster. They don't have to wait on tests to really take action, the necessary action they need to really fight this virus. Obviously, there's been a lot of quarantines in China. There's reports of cruise ships, an Australian cruise ship faces some issues. They're dealing with some issues as well. So that's what's going on with the coronavirus. I hope we don't get another wave of this thing. I just hope they're able to really contain this thing. Hope that what China's doing is working. Although recently the Chinese Communist Party fired two provincial, just basically local government leaders. The people were pretty much at the epicenter of what's going on in China. They basically fired these people, but it's a top-down type of government. You know, it's a lot of people at the bottom, the lower levels. They're just responding to pressures they're getting from people above them. So, there was a Chinese doctor who tried to warn the world about this in December. It was right in December, trying to warn the world about the coronavirus, and this doctor got sick and recently passed away. My thoughts on this is that I'm glad that he tried to at least warn people. He tried to warn doctors and people outside of the community, in different communities, that, hey, there's something going around. And I'm glad that there's still people in this world willing to put the safety of others, even ahead of their own well-being at times. So it just shows you that, you know, some people still care more about the patients and other people around them than just their careers or whatever, because in China, they were really locking down, they were really clamping down on people who were getting certain messages out that they didn't want. Anyway, Bloomberg, speaking of messages, 2015, he was on, there's an audio recording of him talking in 2015 about his infamous stop and frisk policy. Now, of course, in New York City, you know, he was a mayor, he won three elections, he was a mayor for a while, and one of the things he really endorsed, he really supported, was a stop and frisk of young minority males, black males, Latino males. It's a big tactic that they use down there, or up there, I should say. And they basically targeted minorities because, and he said in this tape, the reason why they did that is because it was effective, because he said that, hey, most of the people committing these violent crimes were basically minorities between a certain age group, and that's why we targeted them. Is this going to hurt his presidential hopes, I mean, you know, once the powers that be select somebody, it doesn't matter what they say. I mean, the media is going to fall in line, it doesn't matter. Once the powers that be decide somebody's going to be the next puppet in chief, then that's it. Will this guy be it? I don't think so. I mean, part of the problem is that even when you're trying to appeal to a lot of the people in the Democratic base, a lot of minority voters, is that you got to pitch to them, okay, even though the economy is in great shape, you know, ditch this president, whether you like him, ditch him, and go with somebody else who, you know, who's most likely talking, let's see, Bernie Sanders talking about Medicare for all. I mean, he even admitted that, oh, your taxes may go up, the middle class, their taxes may go up. I mean, is this really a winner for a general election? I don't know. Maybe the country's moving to the left. I don't know. I've been in Eastern Kentucky for the longest. I don't know what's happening with the country, with the rest of the country. You guys tell me. You know, you got Pete, Mayor Pete, who is just as far to the left, almost, except he's just smarter about how he says it, you know, but he's going to carry his own baggage. I don't see a lot of these guys is doing pretty well. Not if the economy holds up. If the economy holds up, I don't see. I don't know. Who do you think has the best chance of beating Trump? Okay. Who do you think has the best chance of beating Trump? And who would you like to see become a Democratic nominee for president of the United States? Anyway. All right. Comments. All right. Carl wrote. Your military budget is like $600 billion. Why do you ask who's going to pay for it when they up the budget by billions recently? Now, okay, I was commenting on Medicare for all. I was saying, who's going to actually pay for all that? And well, I think Bernie Sanders pretty much answered that question when he said the middle class. But anyway, this person's saying we have a big military budget. And it's a valid argument. The thing is, defense is sort of like a core function of a government. At least that's how I view it, the core function of the government. Paying for all your needs, including health insurance, isn't necessarily what I think the core function of the government should be. I'm sure a lot of you guys would disagree. All right, another person, Nat Ram 739 wrote, how will we pay for Bernie's free stuff? I don't know. How do we pay for the wars in the Middle East and the bailouts for the Wall Street bankers? Okay, that's a very good question. I didn't support the bailout for the Wall Street bankers either. To be frank, I didn't support the wars in the Middle East either, to be frank, okay? But we didn't really pay for it. I mean, we're in debt. We didn't really have the money to pay for all this stuff. We didn't really have the money to pay for all these bailouts. We didn't really pay for it, but anyway. We will eventually. All right, Bob Dylan, okay, wrote, don't let yourself get tricked by someone who is attractive and willing. Oh, he's talking about SHTF because there's a crisis situation. I was talking about, you know, who should we help in a crisis situation? And he's basically saying, don't be tricked by someone who's attractive and willing. I guess you can use that piece of advice for non-SHTF, just regular life. There's so many guys who, you know, they spend every bit of their paycheck on some woman who doesn't give a damn about them. And they don't really get anything out of the relationship anyway. I see men driving around in women's cars while the women are at work. You know, these guys are draining these women out of everything they have. Anyway, all right, Stephanie wrote, your first comment is interesting. Deny a small thing and see how that person reacts. Very smart. Okay, I was talking about in SHTF, how do you decide who to really trust? And if you come across a stranger or even somebody you know, and they want something from you, like food or water or whatever, try to deny something really minor from them and see how they react to it. They may reveal their true character right there. Okay, Ruth wrote, side question. We know how you live alone and single, but when we discuss evaluating our survival chances based on family, do you have a support system, group, or family that you're planning on merging with if they... SHTF, if there's a crisis situation. Yeah, that's a really good question. I'm pretty much screwed at this point. I don't really have a lot of support, a lot of people I can really trust, although I'm trying to change. It's hard to really get to the point where you can actually trust somebody, you know, especially when, you know, you've obviously been burned, and just life experiences has just taught me that you gotta be really, really, really careful. But you're right, it is important. Another comment. If someone tries to, I don't know who wrote this, if someone tries to pressure you after you say no, then don't help them. Mind you, they may try to pressure you in a seemingly playful manner. However, you must read between the lines. Adults know what the word no means. If they try to test your no, then they're showing they have no consideration for you. Ah, yes, that's a very good point. You know, you tell somebody no, and they keep pushing, you know. It may go from may I to give me. You can easily go from, yeah, you know, just like if somebody, panhandler, somebody may ask you, you know, you got the time or you got a couple of dollars or whatever, just to really distract you, and you go for your watch or whatever, and that's, you know, they're trying to rob you. I'm just, something to think about. Okay, Targa Wills writes, if it's truly SHTF, then it's SFTL, okay. Shoot first, talk later. Okay, well, I would encourage you to do a little bit more thinking. You know, just because it's SHTF today, a breakdown of law and order today, doesn't mean it's going to be that way tomorrow. Because civilization, law and order may return, and you will be held accountable for your actions. All right, last comment. Joanna, damn. Laugh out loud, SHTF. Might never happen. You've been prepping since 2011. Actually, I've been prepping since 2008, 2009. Yeah, you're right, it may not happen, but you know, the thing about prepping is that if nothing happens, you just have extra food, extra water, and a means of filtering water. You know, if you don't prepare and something happens, then, well, you're screwed. So, thank you for watching, thank you for listening, and don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today.